be seated.
Today's scripture reading is taken from Psalms 99, verses 1 to 9. Psalms 99, verse 1. The Lord reigns, let the peoples tremble. He sits enthroned upon the cherubim, let the earth quake. The Lord is great in Zion, he is exalted over all the peoples. Let them praise your great and awesome name, holy is he. The king in his might loves justice. You have established equity. You have executed justice and righteousness in Jacob. Exalt the Lord our God. Worship at his footstool. Holy is he. Moses and Aaron were among his priests. Samuel also was among those who called upon his name. They called to the Lord and he answered them. In the pillar of the cloud he spoke to them. They kept his testimonies and the statute that he gave them. O Lord, our God, you answered them. You were a forgiving God to them, but an avenger of their wrongdoings. Exalt the Lord, our God, and worship at his holy mountain, for the Lord, our God, is holy. God bless the reading of his holy word. Let me pray for our children before they leave for their children's discipleship class. Dear Lord, be with our children as they learn more about you. Help them to see Jesus as Lord and King. Be with the CD teachers as they faithfully teach truths to their young hearts, that they may learn to love you more and more each day. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Children, you may take your leave for your children's discipleship. Today's message will be brought to us by Mr. Ng Zhiwen, a sermon titled Exalt Our Holy King.
Well, good afternoon, everybody. I know some of us are struggling with a food coma, so maybe we try again, huh? Good afternoon, everyone. I confess it's hard for me as well. I took a nap just before coming here. Well, if you have been following with us through this month of the sermon series, we've been going through the book of Psalms, a certain selection of Psalms that we thought would help us to follow up on a three-month-long series on the book of Ecclesiastes. I was assigned by the preaching team to preach on this particular psalm. It was assigned to me. And I was supposed to talk about justice. And I found out, I thought, oh, well, I can think of other psalms that could speak more clearly on justice. I don't know, Psalm 82, for example. And so as Brother Kwek Zimin can testify, I suggested to him, hey, bro, can I change it on? I speak on Psalm 82, can. But after a while, I felt that the Lord has something to say to us through Psalm 99, which we have just heard read to us. So I don't anyhow go and change that. And we've kept to it. So if you're wondering why the title of the sermon has changed from what was previously announced, now you know why. Little tweaks along the way. As Psalms go, they were meant to be read aloud and sung. Psalm 99 looks like a song with three stanzas plus a bridge in between stanza 2 and stanza 3. And in the final stanza, like maybe everybody says it together. So what I'm going to suggest that we do is we're going to read Psalm 99 again in a call and response format. I will read the words in black, and then you respond by reading the words in red. Ken? But before we do that, let's turn to the Lord in prayer, shall we? Because Father, these words that we are going to read are your words. We sing them as psalms to you, but they are also your words to us. Please open our ears and our eyes to hear you and to see you more and more for who you really are. Help us, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. The Lord reigns. Let the peoples tremble. He sits enthroned upon the cherubim. Let the earth quake. The Lord is great in Zion. He is exalted over all the peoples. The king in his might loves justice. You have established equity. You have executed justice and righteousness in Jacob. Moses and Aaron were among his priests. Samuel also was among those who called upon his name. They called to the Lord, and he answered them. In a pillar of the cloud, he spoke to them. They kept his testimonies and the statute that he gave them. O Lord, our God, exalt the Lord our God and worship at his holy mountain, for the Lord our God is holy. What a psalm, isn't it? What a psalm. It is majestic and austere at the same time. It inspires awe. And the interesting thing is the first call of this psalm is to tremble and quake. To be in awe before the holy king who sits enthroned upon the cherubim. The cherubim are these mighty winged angelic beings. The Lord reigns. Let all the peoples tremble. This first verse is a summons to everyone to praise the holy king. You may not have thought about it like this before, but trembling can be an appropriate form of worship. Tremble because you are in the presence of holiness. That's a key idea in this psalm, as you will see that it is uttered three times in this psalm. Holy is he. Holy is he. The Lord our God is holy. And Psalm 99 will show us a few ways in which the Lord is holy and worthy of our praise as a holy king. You ever wonder what it means to be holy? I've struggled to find a satisfactory dictionary definition of this, but maybe a few words or ideas come to mind that convey a similar meaning. To be holy is to be set apart. Something separate in a different category, you know, as if the Holy One is utterly unlike any other, is so far above all else, incomparable. Sacred. You don't mess around with one who is holy. You must know that you are dealing with someone far greater, way beyond you, far more exalted. This could be new for some of us, and maybe it wasn't part of your first encounter with the Lord. My own first encounter with holiness to some extent was the time when I first came to believe in God. One night as a teenager, I was moved to bow down right beside my bed. And for the first time in my life, I called out to God and I said, I believe you are there. All this while, I never believed you existed. But I believe you are there. And that you are holy. That's what I remember saying as a second or fourth generation Christian. From that moment on, I stopped becoming a practical atheist. I strongly felt the presence of God in my bedroom and I bowed down. It just seemed like the correct posture to be in. As for the first time, I acknowledged God as holy and as king. Do you know how God revealed himself as king in Scripture? There's actually a very important defining moment in Scripture that is appropriate to our psalm, that seems to always be there in the backdrop. Let me ask you, by show of hands, how many of you are familiar with the Exodus? Show of hands. Up means yes. Moses, the Exodus. All right, all of you need to go for OT overview. repeat one more year, okay? Okay, maybe I'll ask the other way. How many of you have never heard of Moses or the Exodus from Egypt? Maybe this is the more correct answer. Well, imagine with me a people subjected to slavery under the hand of Egypt and of Pharaoh, the superpower of that time. Imagine the Lord comes and he performs 10 mighty signs and wonders that breaks the power of Egypt and shows everybody that they are reckoning with a power far mightier than anything they have ever encountered before, than any god they have ever heard of before. The real king is here. And in those series of encounters, it filled the nation of Egypt, that superpower. It filled them with dread, with fear and trembling. Imagine the battle at the Red Sea. After the Israelites had passed through, and the Egyptian army was hot on their heels. Imagine that towering wall of water, the crashing of waves large enough to toss whales, and just so to engulf an entire army. There at the Red Sea, the Egyptian army that was pursuing God's people was swept away by the mighty hand of God, the King. And when Moses and the Israelites witnessed it with their own eyes, they broke out into song. They sang about God's mighty acts, and they sang about the impact that this episode would have on the nations of the world. This is what they sang. First verse, "I will sing to the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously. The horse and his rider he has thrown into the sea. The Lord is my strength and my song, and he has become my salvation. This is my God, and I will praise him. My father's God, and I will exalt him." And then, note this. They sing, "The peoples have heard, they tremble. Trembling seizes the leaders of Moab. Terror and dread fall upon them, till your people, O Lord, pass by. You will bring them in and plant them on your own mountain. The Lord will reign forever and ever." Yeah, this was what they sang when the people of Israel had encountered the mighty hand of the Lord. And they saw how the nations trembled as the Lord redeemed and rescued them, brought them out of Egypt, through the land of Canaan, and into the promised land, where there's this mountain of Zion, where the Lord sets up his throne and establishes himself as king. Nothing like this has happened before. This is what holiness looks like. This is the first sign of God's holiness. He is awesome and mighty, far above any other power. Tremble in his presence. Come and worship him. The second sign of God's holiness comes in the next section, in verses 4 and 5. And that is that the Lord uses his awesome might to bring about justice. It says, "The king in his might loves justice." And then we address the Lord directly. "You have established equity. You have executed justice and righteousness in Jacob," in Israel. So this is a facet of God's holiness. This is what makes the Lord so unique. Justice and righteousness. I mean, think about it. In this world, what do people do when they gain power and might? The tendency is for the mighty to oppress the weak, to perpetuate injustice, to enrich themselves at the expense of others, like what Pharaoh did. In biblical times, what do masters do? They lord it over others. Today, what do bosses do? They boss people. We call our highest government leaders ministers. Ministers, to give the idea that their task is to minister, to serve others, public servants. And maybe we do that because we know all too well that people in power tend to use that power to serve themselves. But the king of all the earth, the mightiest of all lords, loves justice. He uses his strength to set things right, to fight for the oppressed, and for his people who have suffered in slavery. God's people praise him as those who have been rescued, who have seen justice done on their behalf. They saw it, they experienced it when they were rescued from their oppressors, from Egypt. So, dear friends, know this, that at the heart of holiness is a heart for justice. Elsewhere in Scripture, God says, "I, the Lord, love justice. I hate robbery and wrong." Elsewhere, he says, "The Lord is righteous. He loves righteous deeds. The upright shall behold his face." Justice and righteousness are what God wants of us. If we are to be his people, then we are to carry his heart and do the things that reflect his heart. But before we begin to do that, we must first understand that justice is what sets the Lord apart. It is one of the things that defines his holiness. We look around the world today and we ask, who does this kind of thing one? Who uses one's awesome might not to trample down, but to lift up? Only a holy God. And for this reason, everybody come together. Exalt the Lord our God. Worship at his footstool. Holy is he. Oh, but that's not all. There's a third reason why we should exalt the Lord as holy. Because we find that God is not some Batman character. He's not a mass crusader who goes and fights crime, rescues the helpless, and then disappears. Next day you read the newspapers, find out some anonymous person came and caught the criminal bad guys, but we don't know who he is. No, no. God goes to rescue so that he can enter into relationship with us. This is seriously quite an awesome part of God's holiness. And there's an extra stanza to elaborate this, what I may call the bridge. It says in verse 6 and 7, Moses and Aaron were among his priests. Samuel also was among those who called upon his name. They called to the Lord, and he answered them. In the pillar of the cloud, he spoke to them. They kept his testimonies and the statute that he gave them. Now, there are three persons mentioned here, right? Moses, Aaron, and Samuel. Who were they? These three were spokespersons. They stood between God and his people. God speaks to them, and then they go and speak to the people. They would teach God's laws. They would tell God's stories to the people. And on the flip side, the people would cry out to them. And these spokespersons would call out to God on the people's behalf. And that's what priests and prophets do. At some other time, I'd love to talk about this role of being a spokesperson, an intercessor between God and men. But here in this psalm, the big deal is that the Lord actually answered them and spoke to them. Imagine that we can call on the name of the Lord and he answers. Or that someone else can call on the name of the Lord on our behalf and he answers. You tell me, what king answers when we call? Just to give you an example, an illustration, consider Moses. In Exodus chapter 33, we find that Israel, as they made their way to the promised land, they had with them something called the tent of meeting. Everyone who sought the Lord would go to that tent. But Moses would be the guy who actually enters that tent. And each time he did, everyone would rise up and stand at the door of their own tents, and they'll watch Moses enter that tent of meeting. And when Moses entered the tent, guess what happens? The pillar of cloud would descend and stand at the entrance of the tent, and the Lord would speak with Moses. And when all the people saw the pillar of cloud standing at the entrance of the tent, all the people would rise up and worship, each at his tent door. Thus the Lord used to speak to Moses face to face as a man speaks to his friend. You know, when I read this, I think to myself, wow, it's quite an awesome thing, you know, that God can use a person, a man like Moses, to go and confront Pharaoh and warn about those 10 plagues. That's already insanely awesome. But this takes awesomeness to a whole new level, because what king is so far above and yet so near? He comes in a pillar of cloud. Yes, that cloud could represent this mysterious barrier for holiness. You don't anyhow draw near to holiness, right? But yet, it's right there. In the camp, God's presence is there. And he speaks and talks with Moses like how a friend speaks to a friend. They have a living, personal, intimate relationship. To be on speaking terms with the living God. Imagine that. And contrast that with the other gods, the idols, who neither hear nor speak. And think about how much effort has to be put in to try and even get these gods' attention. And you don't know if you will get a response. Brothers and sisters, you and I get to consider a man like Moses, who could talk to God and call on his name, and he answers. The one who makes the earth quake, makes himself present to speak with us, give us his law, tell us what is on his heart, and show us the way to really live. You tell me, what king answers when we call? What kind of king is so far above and yet makes himself so near? Only a holy God. I hope we will never lose this sense of wonder at such privilege. As God's people, we gather here to pray, to seek the Lord together. We have corporate prayer. And when you pray, it's so easy, right? You start to, dear Lord, blah, 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 dot, 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 dot. Someone stands here on the stage each Sunday to call on the Lord on our behalf and to minister God's word to us. God speaks, we get to listen. What an honor, you know. What an honor for us. And not only that, each one of you may personally call on God's name. Each one of us are invited into a personal, vibrant relationship with the King. We need not keep at a distance. And don't let this truth keep you from a distance, but let it encourage you to draw near to him with fear and trembling, but also believing that he responds to those who seek him and call on his name. Well, let me tell you a little bit more about what happened after that first encounter I had with the Lord by my bedside and on my knees. I started to try to take God seriously. I told the Lord, Lord, you are there. You are holy. Don't really know what that means, but that's a word I learned about in Sunday school. You are holy. I guess that makes you king. I guess I better try to take you seriously in my life. And so I sought to live a life that would please him and glorify him. But time and again, if I put my hand on my heart, I had to confess that I wasn't all that good at this holiness thing. I lied, I cheated, I stole, and worst of all, I was proud. Tried to make myself the king of my own life, to exalt myself, make myself feel like I'm better than the others. And I realized that this cannot do for someone who takes God seriously. It made me very troubled. How can I ever live in the presence of the Holy King when time and again I live such an unholy life? I've come to realize that this is the same conflict that many of God's people struggle with. The scriptures tell us that time and again, these people, the Old Testament church, they were such a bunch of stiff-necked, stubborn, rebellious, dirty, rotten scoundrels. They treated it as a light thing that they lived in the presence of God. All this makes me think again of Moses, Aaron, and Samuel. Because you know, when these fellows stood up as spokespersons, many times they did so to intercede with God on behalf of a rebellious people. They stood in the gap between the holy king and his unholy, rebellious people. Moses had to do this so many times, pleading with the Lord to spare the Israelites. Aaron's noteworthy episode was in Numbers 16, where there was a mass rebellion against God. And Aaron had to rush and make atonement for the people as soon as he can, or else people were going to die. In Numbers chapter 16, verse 48, it says that Aaron stood between the dead and the living. And by his act, he saved thousands. As for Samuel, he had to deal with a people who didn't want to acknowledge God as their king. They came out to him, Samuel, can you find us another king? We want a human king. Effectively, they didn't want God as king. I think if I was Samuel, I have a massive headache, I'll throw my hands up in the air, give up. I'm going to sabbatical, I'm not coming back. You go find another prophet, carry on. And yet, Samuel could still say to those same people, far be it from me that I should sin against the Lord by ceasing to pray for you. Even though you are such a nasty lot, no matter what, I will still stand in the gap for you and intercede to the Lord for your sake. These three men understood that if they would stand in the gap and call on the Lord, even on behalf of a persistently rebellious people, God will answer. And once again, if we have more time, I'd love to talk about this wonderful role of being an intercessor for others. But as before, the focus here in this psalm is on the Lord. The psalm gets us to set our minds on God such that we tell him, O Lord, our God, you answered them. You were a forgiving God to them, but an avenger of their wrongdoings. We learn that the Lord has time and again had to put up with the rebellion and disobedience of his people, and time and again, he was a forgiving God. That word, which is translated as forgive, is a very fitting, beautiful word. In the Hebrew, it means to lift up or to carry. And if it helps, the word is actually pronounced NASA, right? So you can think of rockets lifting off. So picture yourself at the feet of the righteous and mighty God, the Holy King, on his throne. And you are down at his feet, and you know full well that you are guilty. You haven't lived as you ought. You know you deserve to be punished, and that you're even deserving of death. Even in many countries today, sedition calls for the death penalty. You wonder how you can ever consider yourself a child of God. Very much the same thing that I struggled with. But then, the Holy King lifts you up. He answers your desperate pleas for mercy, and he forgives. He carries away your guilt. He forgives you of this massive burden that has been weighing on your shoulders and calls you his son and his daughter. That burden is carried away so that you can be lifted up and stand in his presence and be in relationship with him. That is awesome. That is so awesome. That's what sets God apart from all others. It's one of the things that makes him a holy king. Forgiving others, lifting others up. He lifts us up, and that's why we exalt him. To exalt someone is to see that one lifted up as well. To say that there is no God like our God. But a word of caution. Never take advantage of God's forgiving kindness, okay? Never assume that the Lord is some soft-hearted and gullible grandpa who you can trifle with. God is an avenger of wrongdoings. He will avenge the wrongdoings. There will be consequences. There must be justice because God loves justice. Remember that we started in this psalm by trembling before the Lord on his throne. How does that all work out? How does God resolve this avenging justice with his forgiving heart? The psalm never exactly tells us how the Lord will work out all of that, but he does tell us where all things will get resolved. The final verse, Psalm 99, verse 9, gives us a location. It's a holy mountain. It's called Zion. This is the place where all the redeemed people of God will end up, where we will bow down and worship the Lord our God. And for the people of God, the journey to Zion, this mountain, is always a salvation story. A story of God rescuing and drawing people to himself. You've heard of the story of the ancient Israelites. Their salvation story was the rescue from Egypt and being brought into the promised land. This was a journey that they kept going back to time and again and recounting as a great reason to praise the Lord and worship him as holy. They'll say, this is what happened to our forefathers. We join in with them. We say God has saved us. As for us, we have our own salvation story. It is the story of the Lord who came to save the world in such a way that only a holy king can do. You and I have the story of the living God who so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son to be the Savior of the world. And like Moses, this Son of God came and led his people out of the kingdom of darkness and slavery. Like Aaron, this Son of God stood in the gap between the dead and the living and made atonement so that all the wrongs that we have done are avenged on him and we are forgiven. It was on the cross of Calvary where the Son of God was crucified that God's justice and avenging were reconciled with his mercy and forgiveness. And like Samuel, this Son of God ever stands in the presence of the throne of heaven, never ceasing to pray for us, so that on his account, we too can enter into God's presence and be his sons and daughters. This man is Jesus, and everyone who calls on his name will be saved. Wonder of wonders, the Holy King is this man, Jesus, who died to save his people and who rose again to take his rightful place on the throne on that holy mountain. We worship Jesus, the Holy King, and we declare that there's no one like our God. And so everybody now, exalt the Lord our God and worship at his holy mountain, for the Lord our God is holy. One day, we will unite with creation, and joining with all the angels and the elders to worship the Lord our God and declare that he alone is holy and worthy to be praised because of how unique he is, because of how he has saved us. And at that time when we do so, there will not be dread and trembling, but there will be festive celebration. There will be singing, feasting, dancing. And we will be joined by the many who have heard the summons to come to Zion and exalt our holy King. Meanwhile, for us here in Zion, Bishan, this psalm surely can challenge us in so many ways. Every time I read about Zion in the Bible, I think of Zion, Bishan. I cannot help it. May this psalm inspire us and challenge us that we, the people, will be a community that acknowledges that the Lord reigns, that we will be a people that gathers and calls on all people, all other people in the world, to worship this holy King, that we are a people who love justice because we know that the Lord loves justice. And that people who come, they come and they encounter the Holy King who answers when we call on Him. That we may enter into a personal relationship with the King, knowing that He has forgiven us and done what was necessary for us to become His sons and daughters. He wants us to draw near and to call on His name. I invite us all then, in the presence of the Holy One, to turn your eyes now to Him in prayer. We've spoken of how the Lord is so far above and yet so near. And that makes me think about maybe two kinds of people that you may identify with right now. Maybe for some of us who've journeyed long in this Christian life, maybe God has become so familiar that it seems like a light thing to know Him. And that we need to recover the deep sense of holiness. And maybe even to learn to tremble before the Holy King on His throne. For some of us, maybe all your life, or in this season of your life, you don't feel near to God. Maybe you've never known what it means to call on the name of the Lord and to be in relationship with Him. Would you know that someone is standing in the gap for you, doing all that is necessary so that you can be forgiven and you can draw near and encounter the Holy King? Would you hear this invitation, this summons to come to the Lord? For me, it took a bedside encounter on my knees. I don't care what it has to look like for you. But I pray that maybe even today, and maybe even right now, you would have that moment where you set yourself on a journey towards that holy mountain of God and to come to know this King for yourself. Let me give you a few moments to pray in your own words. Now let me pray for you all and for us all. O Lord, our God, You are holy. As we bow down, be lifted up. Be lifted up. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.